Jose P. Rizal, visionary, writer, linguist, patriot. But just how much influence does our national hero have on this new generation? Republic Act 1425 mandates all public and private schools, colleges and universities to include the life and works of Jose Rizal in their curriculum, and for good reason. To this day, Rizal's writings remain truly relevant. It was Rizal who crafted these timeless sayings and lessons. Ang hindi magmahal sa sariling wika, daig pa ang hayop at malansang isda. Ang hindi marunong lumingon sa pinanggalingan ay hindi makakarating sa paroroonan. It is a useless life that is not consecrated to a great ideal. And there can be no tyrants where there are no slaves. As the nation marks the 150th year of his birth, the life and works of Jose Rizal remain as vibrant as ever, his vision of a free Filipino achieved. He once said, "The youth is the hope of our future." It is now a challenge to all young Filipinos to prove that Jose Rizal was right.
It was a life well lived. In all of his 35 years, Jose Rizal was ahead of his time. He was committed to education, to learning new skills, to writing, and to inspiring other Filipinos to dream big and aspire for a better life. At 150, it is time we all get to know the national hero, what he fought for, and how he embodied the new and enlightened Filipino. Our question for you out there, what for you is the greatest lesson from the life of Jose Rizal? With us in our first part of our program, we have three descendants of Jose P. Rizal. First, we have former tourism secretary Gemma Cruz-Araneta. She's a beauty queen. She's the great-granddaughter of Maria, sister of Jose Rizal. Thank you, and it's nice to see you.
Thank you very much,
Gemma. We also have Alberto Filart. He is the great-grandson of Rizal's sister, Olympia.
Yes.
Anak sa tuhod yung great grandson, di ba? Yung bantawag, anak sa tuhod. And we also have Lisa Bayot. She's one of the founders of MyRizal150.com. Mm-hmm. And she is the great granddaughter of Saturnina Rizal, Jose Rizal's eldest sister. At what age, Lisa, did you know? Thank you for being here. You know that you were a great-granddaughter of Jose Rizal.
Well, I have to begin with my grandmother. My grandmother would take us on December 30 for the wreath laying. And that's all. I mean, that's what we would do every year. Because I had never met my grandfather, who is Alfredo Hidalgo, the son of Saturnina.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So that was a ritual in the family.
Yes.
And as you grew older in elementary, in high school, and in college, did your appreciation or your involvement in that ritual become more meaningful?
You know, I'm afraid I was not very much into, I just took it for granted. We really never spoke about it. Mm-hmm. It was just on December 30 when I joined the wreath laying. And other than that, we didn't speak about it and just took it for granted. Ooh. And there was really no talk about it.
Was that the same for you, Mr. Filart?
Well, I think I came to be aware of Rizal when my grandfather, the son of Olympia, started bringing us with him to PGH, Philippine General Hospital. Mm-hmm. He was the head of the ophthalmology department there. Mm-hmm. And I guess he took up ophthalmology because of the proddings of Lolo Jose, mm-hmm. as he calls him, or Tio Jose, as he calls him. And he was really just very proud of talking about him and how he inspired him to help people. That's why he was there with the Philippine General Hospital. Mm-hmm. And I guess my mother thereafter would just, every time she would scold us or give us some lectures, she'd say, "You better behave because you're carrying the name of..."
And did you behave?
Not really to the... I think so. I think we did.
Yeah. And you, Gemma, of course. The first time I heard about you when you won that Miss International beauty pageant, you already put a mark in the minds of a lot of us that you were somebody who knew a lot about Philippine history.
Oh, really?
And was this because of your...
Well, I learned about my relation to the Rizal family when I was 5 years old. And I learned it from my Guerrero grandparents.
Of course.
Dr. Alfredo Guerrero and Filomena Francisco Guerrero, who was the first lady pharmacist. They were admirers of Jose Rizal. So my Lola, my Guerrero Lola, won a beauty contest called Esperanza de la Patria. And that was based on the on reciting the Ultimo Adios.
Mm-hmm.
And my Lolo Alfredo, he would dramatize us like a bedtime story for us. He would dramatize how Rizal turned at the last minute so he would die facing the dawn. So he would dramatize this, and we as children were so fascinated by the way he did it. So we've never stopped talking about Rizal, nor studying him.
Mm-hmm. And you became interested because of your personal interest in history and Philippine culture.
Yes, and of course you sort of ask yourself, why is he the national hero? Why does it look as if he were just standing alone? And then in the 60s, some historians from the University of the Philippines started this black propaganda against Rizal.
That he was an anti-hero?
Well, that he wasn't in favor of the Philippine Revolution.
Yeah, that he was more of the reformist,
exactly,
more than a revolutionary.
And that all these ilustrados were just caciques and they didn't care about the poor people. In short, they were making Rizal and Bonifacio fight each other, years after they were dead. But recently...
But Bonifacio was inspired by Jose Rizal.
Yes, in fact, he was a member of the La Liga Filipina.
Yes.
And he was organizing the popular councils for La Liga Filipina. Mm-hmm. And I think when the Liga Filipina had to close down because Rizal was exiled to Dapitan, then he formed the Katipunan, and he probably thought, this has to be secret, it can't be open like the Liga Filipina. And the picture of Rizal was there in the Katipunan, well, wherever they had their headquarters. Mm-hmm. And the password was Rizal.
Mm-hmm.
So I suppose he was inspired by Jose Rizal.
Yeah.
And by the way,
yes,
he was the first one who translated into Tagalog the Ultimo Adios.
Yes, mm-hmm. Bonifacio did that. Lisa, I was asking you earlier on, was there something that you learned in your being a descendant of Rizal that you never learned, if at all you remember your... your Philippine history of Saide or Agoncillo or even in college. Was there something there that you as a descendant would offer to your classmates? No, this is what was it when we were growing up and going through all of these Rizal or Mercado reunions Guerrero.
On the other hand, it was really, I'm not sure how Gemma and Abbott feel about it, but as a Rizal descendant, I think it's a lot of responsibility to live up to his name. I mean, I can't even name one person who has all his qualities.
Mm-hmm.
And actually, you know, what I'm doing now is has just come to me has just come to me recently.
I know. Mm-hmm.
Yes,
I know. This is something like a movement. 150 to 150.
Yes, it's called the My Rizal 150.
Yes, yes. You have created a lot of stories to a new generation.
Yes, we're really excited about it. It's
and what did you want personally as a descendant to highlight?
To highlight?
Yes.
Well, it first started as an invitation. It became a challenge, and it's now a movement. And our goal is to, you know, to have the Filipinos rediscover Rizal.
Mm-hmm.
And for the young people to, you know, to find meaning in Rizal.
Mm-hmm.
And I think this is the best time. This is the 150th year. And, you know, this is just the kickoff for, you know, for the year to come. Not just a year, but we're thinking of long term.
Yes. Mm-hmm. And Albert, you also belong to My Rizal 150 or you are on your own just doing...
We collaborate. And
you collaborate. Uh-huh. You
as
descendants
yes,
are part of all of this movement.
Mm-hmm.
And what is it personally as a descendant? Do you want the other people, like the youth and the rest of the
Filipinos. Like Lisa was saying, revisiting Rizal, to me, more than just revisiting Rizal and his work as just good literary works, I think we have to look into the spirit of what he was saying.